In the last session, we discussed about the optical receiver and fiber optic measurements. In this session, I will be talking about optical networks and system transmission. These are the topics we are going to discuss in this session: SONET SGH network, solitons, optical CDMA, broadcast and select WDM networks, wavelength routed networks, nonlinear effects on network performance, and ultra high capacity networks. SONET. Let me tell you what is SONET and SGH network.
SONET and SGH network. SONET stands for synchronous optical network and SGH stands for synchronous digital hierarchy. Both of them are standardized protocols for optical communication system. SONET is developed by ANSI, that is American Nation Standards Institute. SONET is used in US and Japan, whereas SGH is used in the other parts of the world. SGH is developed by ITUT, that is International Telecommunication Union, Telecommunication Standardization Sector.
They are originally developed by Bellcore. Coming to advantages of SONET, SONET has got a flexible architecture with a variety of transmission rates. Availability of a set of generic standards that enable products from different vendors to be connected. Then the third one is reduction in equipment requirements and so increase in network reliability. Next, provision of overhead and payload bias is an advantage of SONET. Lastly, synchronous MUX format for carrying low level signals like DS1, DS2, DS3, etc. Next, we shall see the SONET equipments. This is a simple network consisting of SONET devices. These are the terminals at the source end and these are the terminals at the destination end. STS MUX is nothing but synchronous transport signal MUX. STS DMUX is synchronous transport signal demultiplexer. And as shown in this diagram, the communication or the data flow between STS MUX and regenerator, that is the data flow between any two adjacent SONET devices, is taken care or is done in the section layer. Later on, I'll be talking about the different layers of SONET. Similarly, these two are the adjacent devices. Here is a regenerator and here is the add-drop MUX. Add-drop MUX, in short, it is called as ADM. ADM or add-drop multiplexer can perform many different functions. Its main function is to add or drop individual STS signals from the higher rate traffic stream without disturbing the existing signals. And the data flow between this regenerator and the adjacent SONET device ADM will also be done in the section layer. Similarly, the data flow between add-drop MUX and this generator, as well as the data flow between regenerator and STS DMUX, will be done in the section layer. Next, as you can see here in the diagram, the communication between STS MUX and the add-drop MUX will be done in the line layer. In between, there can be any number of SONET devices, but the line layer takes care of data flow between one STS MUX and add-drop MUX. Similarly, data flow between add-drop MUX and STS DMUX also will be done in the line layer. Next is the path layer. The path layer takes care of communication between source and the destination, that is between STS MUX at the transmitting side and STS DMUX at the receiving end. We shall now discuss about the SONET layers. The bottommost layer is the photonic layer. It corresponds to physical layer of OSI model. There are about four layers in SONET network. The bottommost is photonic layer. It is responsible for conversion of electrical signal into optical signals. In photonic layer only, the conversion of electrical signal to optical signal takes place. And all the devices in the SONET interact at the photonic layer only. This layer is mainly concerned with a power level, power save or pulse save, and wavelength of light. Next comes the section layer. The section layer, line layer and path layer corresponds to data link layer of the OSI model. Section layer takes care of framing and scrambling of traffic. It is defined as the interconnection of any two adjacent network elements. The network elements that work at the section layer are called as section terminating equipment, STE. Next comes the line layer. The function of the line layer is error checking, performance monitoring, line maintenance and protected switching. It is used to support the traffic flow between two adjacent SONET multiplexers. The topmost layer is a path layer. The path layer serves as a logical connection between the entry point, that is the source of a SONET network, and the destination point. The path layer is responsible for the transport of payloads between SONET terminal multiplexing equipment. The devices that terminate a path layer are called path terminating equipments, referred as PTE. This diagram shows the device layer relationship in a SONET. As you can see in this diagram, the communication starts from the path layer like this. It flows down through the line layer, section layer and photonic layer in the STS MUX, and towards the regenerating end, these two layers are responsible for communication between STS MUX and regenerator, and between regenerator and airdrop MUX, the optical signal flows like this. It goes on like this and it reaches the destination end. Now let's discuss about STS-1 frame. STS-1 stands for Synchronous Transport Signal 1. It consists of 90 octets per row, having 9 rows and 90 columns. Like this, 9 rows. Out of 90 columns, these 3 columns are reserved. So 9 by 87. Totally, STS-1 frame is 810 bytes, 9 by 90 gives 810. Of this is called as TOH, that is transport overhead, consisting of 27 bytes, and this portion is called SPE, that is synchronous payload envelope, consisting of 783 bytes. That is 810 minus 27 gives rise to 783 bytes. The first 3 rows is called section overhead, consisting of 9 bytes, and the last 6 rows are called as line overhead, consisting of 18 bytes. Structure of SONET frame. This is how the SONET frame structure will be. Section overhead consisting of 9 bytes, that the first 3 bytes of first 3 rows. Next, line overhead 18 bytes, first 3 bytes of last 6 rows in a SONET frame. The remaining is SPE. One STS-1 signal can contain, or one STS-1 frame can contain 7 VTGs, virtual tributary groups. We shall see now how the SONET frame gets transmitted. The frame gets transmitted like this, one by one from left to right. So 8000 frames can be transmitted from per second. The bit rate of STS-1 SONET frame can be calculated as 810 bytes in a frame. One frame consists of 810 bytes, and as you all know, one byte consists of 8 bits, and there are about 8000 frames transmitted per second. So if you multiply 810 into 8 into 8000, it comes around 51.84 megabit per second. So duration of a SONET frame is 1 by 8000 seconds or 125 microseconds. This table gives the SONET and SDH rates. As we have seen just before, STS-1 signal, the bit rate of STS-1 signal is 51.84 megabit per second, and just now I explained how to achieve this calculation. Similarly, the bit rate for STS-3, 9, 12, 18, 24, 36, 48, 96, 192 can be calculated. If you multiply 51.84 into 3, you get this value as 155.520. Similarly, it can be calculated for other signals also. As I have already told you, STS stands for Synchronous Transport Signal and OC Optical Signal. Next is STS Multiplexing. In SONET, frames of lower rate can be synchronously time division multiplexed into higher rate frame as shown in the figure. Here, the STS-1 frames are multiplexed into higher rate stream called STS-3. That is, the frames of lower rate can be synchronously time division multiplexed into higher rate frames. Now let us discuss about the architecture of SONET and SDH network. SONET architecture is divided into two types. One is unidirectional pass switch ring network, called as two fiber unidirectional pass switch ring network UPSR, and the other one is four fiber bidirectional line switch network BLSR, which we'll be discussing later. Now coming to unidirectional pass switch ring network, consider this example shown in the figure. This picture shows four nodes, node 1, node 2, node 3 and node 4. Node 1 is connected to node 2, that is the data flow between node 1 and node 2 is by this, using this link, and from node 2 to node 3 the data flows through this link. Similarly, from node 3 to node 4 this link is used, and from node 4 to node 1 this link is used. Now if you consider the data flow from node 1 to node 3, for example, the data flows in clockwise direction. The links are numbered as 1, 2, 3 and 4. That means the links 1, 2, 3 and 4 follow a clockwise directional flow. Similarly, the data can flow in the opposite direction, that is in the counterclockwise direction also, as shown in the figure. The dotted line shown in red color indicates the direction of data flow in counterclockwise direction, and the links are numbered as 5, 6, 7 and 8. So the links 1, 2, 3 and 4 are used for data flow in clockwise direction, and the links 5, 6, 7 and 8 are used for data flow in counterclockwise direction. Now consider the data flow between node 1 and node 3. Let us consider node 1 wants to transmit some data to node 3. It uses link number 1 and 2 in clockwise direction for normal data flow. On the other hand, if the node 3 wants to transmit data to node 1, it uses link 3 and 4 in clockwise direction. So which means the entire perimeter of the ring is used by these two nodes, node 1 and node 3. That is, the two communicating nodes use a specific bandwidth capacity around the entire perimeter of the ring. The same signal can be fed through the other direction also, that is from node 1 to node 4, node 4 to node 3, 3 to 2 and 2 to 1 in the counterclockwise direction. So both identical signals reach the destination node 3 from opposite directions with the different delays, and the receiver normally selects the signal from the primary path. If any path is damaged, then the signal will be sent using this protection path. So the thicker lines are called as primary path lengths, and the dotted lines shown here refers to protection path. So the next diagram clearly gives an idea how the data flow is transmitted between node 1 and node 3. So same data flows in the other direction also. Now let us see the advantages of two fiber unidirectional pass switch ring. The first point is self-healing. This type of architecture has got an advantageous point, that is self-healing. Coming to disadvantages, the waste of channel bandwidth. Since the entire perimeter of the ring is used here, the total channel bandwidth is wasted. And next is, if both the primary and the protection path fails, then the signal is totally lost, so it is of no use. So to overcome this, we move for 4 fiber bidirectional line switch ring network called as BLSR. Now if you consider this diagram, here 2 primary fiber loops are used for communication in the same direction. Similarly, 2 secondary fiber loops are used for protection path. Here the links numbered as P, 1P, 2P, 3P, 4P, etc. are primary paths, and the links numbered as 1S, 2S, 3S, etc. are secondary paths. So the links 1P to 4P, 1, 2, 3 and 4P forms primary path clockwise, and the links 5P, as shown in this diagram here, this link 5P, 6P, 7P and 8P forms primary path in the counterclockwise direction. Similarly, links 1S, 2S, 3S and 4S forms protection path or the secondary path in the clockwise direction, and the links 5S, 6S, 7S and 8S forms protection or secondary path in the anti-clockwise direction. Now for example, consider node 1 to be the transmitted node and node 3 as the destination node. Now in order for the data to flow from node 1 to node 3, the links 1P and 2P here, this one, are used in clockwise direction. And similarly, the link in the reverse direction, the primary path links 7P and 8P are used for transmitting data from node 3 to node 1. So here only half the perimeter of the ring is used, not like before as in the case of unidirectional path switch ring. This is the advantage in this case. So the channel bandwidth here is half that of UPSR. Now if the primary path or a circuit card in the node 3 or 4 here fails, then in this case both the primary fibers switch to secondary pair as shown here. If any fault occurs here, then both the nodes switch to secondary protection path. So now the protection path between or the protection segment between the nodes 3 and 4 becomes part of the primary bidirectional loop. So the other links remain unaffected. If the entire node fails, the nodes on either side of the failed node switch the primary path connections from their receivers and transmitters to the protection fibers. So this process forms a closed ring. Coming to the advantages in this case, only half the perimeter of the ring is used, as I told before. Then the increased capacity, since it uses twice as much of fiber cabling. So compared to unidirectional path switch ring, bidirectional line switch ring is more advantageous. Then now we'll start with solitons. Solitons are very narrow optical pulses like this with a very high peak powers that retain their shapes as they propagate along the fiber. They do not change their shape. These soliton pulses, when they travel inside the fiber, optical fiber, they retain their shapes. So these pulses are propagating through the fiber may get broadened due to group velocity dispersion. So this is compensated by the compression of the pulse, which results from cell phase modulation, which we'll be discussing later. Pulses that do not undergo any change in shape are called fundamental solitons, and the pulses that undergo periodic changes are known as higher order solitons. In space, if there is no change in shape, then it is called spatial solitons, and in time, if there is no change in shape, it is called temporal solitons. They both exhibit wave-like and particle-like property. It has unique collision and interactive property. So depending on the geometry, the number of solitons can be conserved or not conserved. Now let's see the properties of solitons. As I have told before, solitons are special kind of pulses or self-trapped beams, you can say, that do not change shape during propagation. Now coming to properties of solitons, solitons do not change in shape when they propagate through the fiber, and they are flat plane wave phase front. And the third property is it has got infinite non-linear phase shift. Now we shall discuss about the optical CDMA. Look at the diagram here. So before going into optical CDMA, let me just tell you about optical time division multiple axis OTDMA, optical frequency division multiple axis OFDMA, then I'll come back to optical CDMA. In optical TDMA, the time slot is allocated for each user in the network. So that is, each user can transmit data through the fiber cable at the specific time slot. But the disadvantage in that case is wastage of bandwidth. And the advantage of OTDMA is no co-channel interference, that is no crosstalk. And in the case of optical frequency division multiple access, OFDMA, the frequency slot is allocated for each user with godband in the network. The advantages of OFDMA is maximum bandwidth of optical fiber is utilized, and the disadvantages of OFDMA is occurrence of crosstalk. Now coming to our topic, optical CDMA, instead of allocating slot like in TDMA or FDMA, here in this case a separate code is allocated for each user in the network. Using split spectrum techniques, the user data is spread over wideband pseudo noise sequence. So all the users in the network are assigned a unique code for correct detection in wireless communication application. The unique code assigned to each user are orthogonal to each other, and the data signal spreads in a code called chip. The length of the code determines the maximum number of users that can be added in the network. Since each user is allocated a unit code, the length of the code determines how many maximum number of users can be added in the network. And the receiver with a barcode which matches the transmitter can be decoded and the information can be recovered. Here three processes are involved, namely optical broadband source as shown here, spatial filter with barcode, and optical modulator. All the user can derive data, they can get data signal from single broadband optical source. This complex spatial filter with the barcode is specifically used to code the light signal. Then the coded light is fed to the optical modulator here and is transmitted through optical cable in the data rate OC3 155 megabits per second. Advantages of OCDMA: high security, simple implementation using existing fiber networks, and reduction of cost. These are the advantages of optical CDMA. Coming to fiber spectrum of OCDMA, OCDMA divides the entire fiber spectrum into individual codes. The signal that spreads in the code is called chip, and this is TC. This duration is TC, is represented as TC, which is called as chip duration. Next, we shall discuss about the broadcast and select network. In broadcast and select network, a node sends its transmission to the star coupler. Here you can see the star coupler, and the nodes are shown here. Each node sends its transmission to the star coupler on their own available wavelengths, which produce an optical information stream. So that information stream is collected by the star coupler. There it is combined, and this star coupler splits equally and forward it to all other nodes. So this star coupler is going to receive all the information transmitted from all the nodes, and then it is going to transmit to all the receivers. In this example, n number of nodes are shown: node 1, node 3, node 2, node 3, etc. till node n. Node 1 transmits using a wavelength lambda 1, node 2 transmits using wavelength lambda 2, and so on. So n sets of transmitters and receivers can be attached to either star coupler shown here, or it can be attached even to a passive bus as shown here. This is a passive common bus. So each transmitter sends its information at a different fixed wavelength, lambda 1, lambda 2, etc. to lambda n. All the information are sent to the passive star coupler, and the result is sent out to all the receivers. All the receivers receive, or it sees all the wavelengths. All the receivers are capable of seeing all the wavelengths, but selects only one wavelength addressed to it using a tunable filter. So the receivers can receive their intended wavelength by using tunable filters. And there are two different types of broadcast and select WDM networks. WDM stands for wavelength division multiplexing, single hop and multi hop net broadcast WDM network. In single hop broadcast WDM network, no intermediate nodes are required, whereas in multi hop broadcast and select WDM network, intermediate nodes are required. And there are two problems that may arise in broadcast WDM network. One is need of more wavelengths as the number of nodes in the network grow. So as the number of nodes go on increasing in a network, more number of wavelengths are to be included. And second point is, without the use of optical amplifier, a large number of users cannot be interconnected with the broadcast and select network. So it needs definitely an optical amplifier. Single hop broadcast and select network. Look at the diagram here. Passive star coupler is used, and five nodes are shown in this diagram: node 1, node 2, node 3, node 4, and node 5. Similarly, n number of nodes can be attached to the star coupler or a passive common bus. Each transmitter transmits its information in a fixed wavelength. In this diagram, node 1 transmits using a fixed wavelength lambda 1, and node 2 transmits using a fixed wavelength lambda 2, and so on. So no intermediate relaying nodes are needed here. The destination node decodes information packet and identifies its address, and then it recovers the information using tunable optical filter by selecting the appropriate wavelength of the source node. When the source node transmits information, all other nodes in the network receive the information. Using tunable filter, each intended receiver receives their own information. In this example, node 1, let us assume node 1 wants to transmit something to node 3 here. So node 1 directly transmits to a destination node. So it is called a single hop network. Via this passive star coupler, node 1, using lambda 1 wavelength, it transmits to node 3. Here you can see lambda 1 wavelength is used. So since node 1 is transmitting directly to node 3 via this passive star coupler, this type of network is called single hop network. Here no intermediate relaying nodes are required and no intermediate electro-optical conversion is also needed. Though the architecture is simple, much care should be taken in this case. If a transmitter sends its information at a fixed wavelength, then the intended receiver should be informed so that it can use or it can tune its selective filter to that particular wavelength and receive its own information. The advantages of single hop broadcast and select WDM network is that the architecture is very simple and the protocol is transparent. Coming to limitations, large number of tunable optical filters are needed for wavelength conversion and the chance of packet collision at the destination node is possible. Next is multi-hop broadcast and select network. Just have a look at the diagram. The drawback of single hop network is that it needs a tunable filters. They do not have a direct path between each node pair. Via the passive filter only it has to transmit the information. Each node transmits information here. In this case, each node transmits information at two different wavelengths. You can see node 1 transmits information at two different wavelengths, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and same node 1 receives the data at two different wavelengths, lambda 5 and lambda 7. Similarly, node 2 transmits using lambda 3 and lambda 4 and receives using lambda 6 and lambda 8. Similarly, it happens with node 3 and node 4. So in this case, in multi-hop broadcast and select network, each node transmits its information at two fixed wavelengths and receives information at two fixed wavelengths. In this example, let us assume node 1 wants to transmit its data to node 2. It cannot transmit directly because the node 1 transmits information using the wavelengths lambda 1 and lambda 2 and it receives information using lambda 5 and lambda 7. But none of these wavelengths are used in this link. In the node 2, for transmission, lambda 3, lambda 4 is used and for reception, lambda 6 and lambda 8 is used. So node 1 cannot transmit directly to node 2. So what it does is, it transmits via the star coupler to node 3. Here node 3 uses or it receives from star coupler using this lambda 1 wavelength. So whatever data is transmitted by node 1 using lambda 1 will be received by the node 3 using lambda 1 wavelength, and in turn the node 3 sends its information back to the star coupler using this wavelength, any of the wavelengths lambda 5 and lambda 6. From node 3 it reaches star coupler, and from star coupler the information or the data reaches node 2 using this lambda 6 wavelength. So here definitely intermediate relaying nodes are needed, and the intermediate electro, when intermediate nodes are needed, definitely intermediate electro-optical conversion occurs. If there are n hops between the nodes, then the network throughput penalty in this network is 1 by n. Now let us see the representation of fields contained in a data packet. At each intermediate node, the optical signal is converted into an electrical format and the address header is decoded so that the routing information field indicates where exactly the packet should go. Nonlinear effects on network performance. There are certain challenges that should be met while designing optical networks. First one is, different wavelength channels should be transmitted at higher possible bit rate. Secondly, long distance transmission should be possible with smaller number of optical amplifiers. Third one is, the network architecture should be designed in such a way that It allows simple and efficient network operation with control and management. There are two nonlinear effects. First one is due to nonlinear inelastic scattering process. In that we have two types, stimulated Raman scattering SRS and stimulated Brillouin scattering SBS. Second one is due to refractive index dependence on intensity changes. In that we have three types, cell phase modulation SPM, cross phase modulation CPM and four-wave mixing FWM. Stimulated Raman scattering. Stimulated Raman scattering is an interaction between light waves and vibrational modes of silica molecules. That is, if a photon with energy H mu 1 as shown here is incident on a molecule with the vibrational frequency mu m, then the molecule will absorb some energy from the photon. So in this interaction, the photon is scattered by attaining a very lower frequency called mu 2 and the corresponding energy with H mu 2. This modified photon thus obtained is called as Stokes photon. And if two or more optical signals at different wavelengths as shown here as lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 and lambda 4, these optical signals with different wavelengths, when they are injected into a fiber like this, then SRS causes energy from lower wavelength channels to be transferred to higher wavelength channels. So this reduces the signal to noise ratio of lower wavelength channels and introduces crosstalk on the information carrying capacity of the system. The threshold power in this case is given by PTH is equal to 16 AEFF divided by GR and LEFF. Here GR is the Raman gain and LEFF is the effective length of the fiber. If the fiber is long, then L effective will be equivalent to 1 by alpha. In that case, the threshold power PTH is changed as 16 alpha divided by GR. For a silica fiber with a wavelength of 1550 nanometer, the values of GR, alpha and A effective are shown here. The threshold power, if you substitute all these values, then the threshold power PTH comes around 570 milliwatts. Hence, the effect of SRS is insignificant in the case of a single channel. This graph shows the linear approximation for Raman gain coefficient. Here you can see the Raman gain increases linearly as this. Next one is stimulated Brillouin scattering. Stimulated Brillouin scattering arises when a strong optical signal generates an acoustic wave that produces variations in the refractive index. These index variations causes light waves to scatter in the backward direction, that is towards the transmitter again. So this backscattered light experiences a gain from the forward propagating signals, which leads to the depletion or decrease in the signal power. So the frequency of the scattered light experiences a shift called Doppler shift, given by nu b is equal to 2n into nu s divided by lambda, where n is the index of refraction and nu s is the velocity of sound in the material. In silica, this interaction occurs over a very narrow Brillouin line width of lambda 2b is equal to 20 megahertz at 1550 nanometer, and the threshold power PTH is given by 2L AEFF into B divided by GB into LEFF, the whole multiplied by 1 plus delta V source divided by delta VB, where EFF is the effective cross-sectional area of the propagating wave, B is the propagation factor, LEFF is the effective length, and GB is the Brillouin gain coefficient. This shows the effect of SBS on signal power. This graph is drawn with respect to relative backscattered optical power and transmitted optical power and the received optical power. Here you can see below the SBS threshold, the transmitted optical power increases linearly. Below the SBS threshold, the transmitted power increases linearly with the input level. So the effect of SBS is negligible for these low power levels and becomes greater as the optical power level increases. Next, this shows the SBS impairment on CNR, carrier to signal noise ratio, of AM, that is amplitude modulated vestigial sideband signal. As you can see in the graph, this is the CNR. See, it increases till the threshold point and then it starts decreasing. There are certain schemes for reducing the power penalty effects of SBS. The first one is keeping the optical power below SBS threshold. Second one, increasing the line width of the source. And third one, slightly dithering the laser output in frequency. Coming to the next nonlinear effect called self-phase modulation. If an ultra short pulse with constant phase travels in a medium, then the optical carrier effect produces a refractive index change with intensity. That is, the SPM converts optical power fluctuations in a propagating light wave to spurious phase fluctuations in the same wave due to carrier effect. So as a pulse propagates, the intensity at any one point in the medium rises, as you can see here, and then falls as the pulse moves apart. This leads to time varying refractive index. As you can see in the graph, the leading edge of the pulse causes the refractive index of the fiber to increase, causing a blue shift, and the falling edge of the pulse causes the refractive index to decrease, causing a red shift. This variation in refractive index shifts the instantaneous phase of the pulse. The phase shift in turn results in frequency shift. The primary effect of SPM is to broaden the pulse and frequency domain, keeping the temporal shape unaltered, while the dispersion causes broadening of pulse in time domain, keeping the spectral components unaltered. And the frequency shift is given by this formula. Del B is equal to gamma LEFF into dP by dt, where dP by dt is the time derivative of the pulse power, gamma is a nonlinear coefficient, and LEFF is the effective length. When there are more than one optical signal propagating through the fiber, as in multi-channel WDM, the nonlinear phase shift of the signal not only depend upon its own power but also on the power of other signals. Coming to applications of self-phase modulation, number one is spectral broadening, number two is temporal pulse compression, number three is spectral pulse compression. cross-phase modulation. When two co-propagating light pulses traveling in two different wavelengths of light, then one wavelength of light can affect the phase of another wavelength of light due to optical carrier effect. This effect is called as cross-phase modulation. This cross-phase modulation, denoted by XPM, converts power fluctuations in a particular wavelength channel to phase fluctuations in another co-propagating channels due to optical carrier effect. When there is more than one optical signal propagating through the fiber, as in multi-channel WDM, the non-linear phase shift of the signal not only depends on its own power but also on the power of other signals. For example, if there are four signals as shown here in this expression, the non-linear phase shift of the first signal is given by this expression. In this, the first term causes due to self-phase modulation and this term is due to cross-phase modulation. The frequency shift produced in this case is given by this equation, del phi is equal to dou phi by dou t, that is equal to 2 gamma into L effective into dp by dt, where gamma here is a nonlinear effect coefficient and p is the optical power and L effective is the effective length of the fiber. Coming to advantages of cross-phase modulation, there are three advantages. Number one is nonlinear pulse compression, ultra-fast optical switching and wavelength conversion of WDM channels. Coming to disadvantages, these are the disadvantages of cross-phase modulation. One is inter-channel crosstalk can occur in WDM systems. And second one is amplitude and timing delay. Next nonlinear effect what we are going to discuss is the four-wave mixing. In a WDM system, due to nonlinear nature of the refractive index, when signals of frequencies like shown here as VI, VJ and VK propagate in the fiber, then nonlinear interaction will generate new components at frequency VIJK given by VI plus VJ minus VK with I, J not equivalent to K. When this new frequency generated falls in the transmission window of the original frequencies, then it can cause severe crosstalk. This figure shown in this example for two waves at frequencies V1 and V2. As these waves co-propagate along a fiber, they mix with each other and generate side bands as shown here, 2V2 minus V1 here and another side band here. Similarly, three co-propagating waves will create 9 new optical sideband waves at frequencies. These side bands, as shown in this figure, will travel along with the original waves and it will grow at the expense of signal strength depletion. So if there are n number of wavelengths, then the number of generated mixing products will be m is equal to n squared by 2 into n minus 1. And the new frequencies generated, the sidebands, will be as shown here. The disadvantage in this case is inter-channel crosstalk occurs in four-wave mixing. Wavelength routing network. Two problems arise in broadcast and select networks. One is more number of wavelengths are needed as the number of nodes in the network grows. And without the use of optical booster amplifiers, a large number of users spread over a wide area and cannot be readily connected with a broadcast and select network. This is because of splitting losses of passive star couplers used in the network. Wavelength routed networks overcome these limitations through wavelength reuse, wavelength conversion and optical switching. It is basically consists of optical cross connects, that is routing nodes, interconnected by point-to-point fiber links in an arbitrary topology. Valence routed WDM networks have the potential to avoid three problems as I have discussed just now, that is lack of wavelength reuse, path splitting loss and scalability to wide area networks. In this topology, the wavelength router network consists of optical wavelength routers interconnected by pairs of point-to-point fiber links in an arbitrary mesh configuration. And here, each link can carry a certain number of wavelengths which can be directed independently to different output paths of a node. And each node can have logical connection with several other nodes in the network. And it provides a path taken by any two connections and do not overlap and can use the same wavelength, thereby the number of wavelengths will be greatly reduced. In this type of network, each end node, that is end user, is connected to an optical cross connect through a fiber link. In a wavelength router network, the message is sent from one node to another node using a wavelength continuous route called a light path without requiring any optical, electronic and optical conversion and buffering at the intermediate nodes. This process is known as wavelength routing. Next we will see what are optical cross connects. Optical cross connects is an optical switch as shown in this diagram. This picture or this diagram shows an optical cross connect. This is an optical network that consists of optical cross connects interconnected by WDM fibers, with each fiber consisting of W wavelengths. Optical cross connect switches optically connect all the incoming wavelengths of the input fibers to the outgoing wavelengths of the output fibers. For instance, it can switch the optical signal on incoming wavelength lambda I of input fiber K to the outgoing lambda J of output fiber M. If optical cross connect is equipped with converters, then it can also switch the optical signal of the incoming wavelength lambda I of the fiber K to another outgoing wavelength lambda J of the output fiber M. This happens when the lambda I wavelength of the output fiber M is in use. This diagram shows the wavelength routing network. An optical cross connect can also be used, this is the optical cross connect, it can also be used as OADM. OADM stands for optical add drop multiplexer. That is, it can terminate the optical signal of a number of incoming wavelengths lambda S and insert new optical signals on the same wavelength in an output port. The remaining incoming wavelengths are switched through as given in the diagram. In this diagram, the wavelengths lambda 1 to lambda W are shown. Wavelength routing network is also called as circuit switch network. If an user wants to send data to another user, then a connection has to be first set up. This connection is a circuit switch connection and it is established by allocating a wavelength on each hop like this along the connections throughout. Ultra high capacity networks. In addition to using dense wavelength division multiplexing techniques to increase the capacity of long haul transmission links, ultra fast optical TDM schemes have been employed. These are particularly attractive in LANs and MANs network. Two popular approaches are used to achieve increased capacity. Number one is to widen the spectral bandwidth of EDFA. EDFA is erbium doped fiber amplifier, from 30 to 80 nanometers by using broadening techniques. Second one is increasing the capacity of a WDM link to improve the spectral efficiency of WDM signals. For this, two methods are employed. One is bit interleave optical TDM, the second one is time slotted optical TDM. The examples for this network are a 50 channel WDM system operating at an aggregated 1 terabit per second over 600 kilometer length. And another example is a 132 channel WDM system operating at an aggregated 2.6 terabit per second over a 120 kilometer length. Now let us see bit interleaved optical TDM. You can see the diagram here. Bit interleaved TDM is similar to WDM in that the access nodes share small channels operating at a peak rate in a fraction of a media rate. Here, a laser source produces a regular stream of very narrow optical pulses. You can see the laser source here. It produces very narrow optical pulses in the form of return to zero form at a repetition rate B. The repetition rate typically ranges from 2.5 to 10 gigabit per second, which corresponds to the bit rate of the electronic data tributaries feeding the system. And this optical splitter here divides the pulse train into n separate streams as shown here. Here n is equal to 4. The pulse stream is 10 gigabit per second in this network. And each of these channels are individually modulated using these modulators at a bit rate B. The modulated outputs are then delayed individually by different fractions of the clock period and then interleaved through an optical combiner to produce a bit rate of N into B. Optical post amplifiers and pre amplifiers are included in the link mainly to compensate for splitting and attenuation losses. At the receiving end, the pulse stream is demultiplexed into the original and independent data channels for further signal processing. A clock recovery circuit included here operating at the base bit rate B is needed at the receiver to drive and synchronize the demultiplexer. In a time slotted TDM, the access nodes share one fast channel which is capable of sending burst rays at 100 gigabit per second. In such systems, the generation of a high speed signal with a uniform pulse separation is important for suppressing crosstalk effects from adjacent pulses. The most important features of time slotted optical TDM network are: number one is to provide a backbone to interconnect high speed networks. Number two, to transport quickly very large data blocks. Number three, to switch large aggregations of traffic. Number four, to provide both high data rate. And number five, to provide low rate access to users. The advantages of this ultra high capacity network are: depending on the user rate, it can provide traffic statistics. Second one is improvements in terms of shorter user access time. Third, it produces lower delay. Fourth, higher throughput. And number five, N node equipment is simpler for single channel versus multi-channel approaches. For this module, I have referred these textbooks and the e-books. Thank you. Have a good day.